Hello friends, this is Team SuperSimplified and today we are here with UPSC Prelims 2017 solution with explanation. You can download all the slides of all our lectures from the download link provided in the description section of every video, right? So let's get started. So this is the distribution of questions section wise in this year's paper. So these are the main topics, the broad areas of the syllabus, and this is the number of questions from each of these areas. An important observation here is that there were maximum number of questions from polity this year. There were around 22 questions, and if you talk about current affairs, then there were around 33 questions from current affairs directly or indirectly. But hum isme zyada detail mein nahi jayenge. We'll not go into the details because this pattern is not constant and it is going to change every year, and don't base your next year's preparation based on this pattern. Don't start, you know, ignoring other subjects and focusing 100% on polity, because this changes every year and UPSC is popular for the surprise element in its paper. That is why I'm not going into the details. If you're interested, you can just go through these numbers, and this is the graphical representation of the same data, right? You can go through that. We'll straight away move to the questions. So the question number one is, which one of the following was a very important seaport in the Kakatiya kingdom? A. Kakinada, B. Motupalli, C. Machilipatnam or Masulipatnam, and D. Nelluru. Correct answer here is B. Motupalli. Let me give you some additional information about Kakatiya kingdom. Kakatiya was a dynasty of the South India and the Telugu speaking regions of the country, and their capital was at the present day Warangal, and it was present from 1163 AD to 1323 AD in the southern India. This is the territory of Kakatiya kingdom, shaded in the green color. And Kakatiyas are famous for their massive constructions. Like most of the ancient kingdoms, they constructed massive gateways and temples. One of the famous temple is Thousand Pillar Temple in Warangal. Now coming to question number two, with reference to Global Climate Change Alliance, which one of the following statements is or are correct? Statement number one, it is an initiative of European Union. Statement number two, it provides technical and financial support to targeted developing countries to integrate climate change into their development policies and budgets. Statement number three, it is coordinated by World Resource Institute and World Business Council for Sustainable Development. Select the correct answer using the code given below. Now before answering the question, let's have a quick glance at what is GCCA. The GCCA Global Climate Change Alliance was actually established by the European Union in 2007 to strengthen the dialogue and cooperation with developing countries, in particular the least developed countries and the small island developing states. And the alliance actually helps to ensure that poor and developing countries, which are most vulnerable to climate change, they increase their capacities to adapt to the effects of climate change, right? So the alliance actually to help the developing countries fight climate change, right? And this is an initiative of European Union, started in 2007. Statement number one is, it is an initiative of the European Union. This is correct. It provides technical and financial support to targeted developing countries to integrate climate change into their development policies and budgets. This statement is correct. We have seen in the previous slide. It is coordinated by World Resource Institute and World Business Council for Sustainable Development. This statement is not correct. These agencies do not have a role to play in this particular initiative, right? So the correct answer here is 1 and 2 only. That is A. Okay. Now let's come to question number 3. With reference to religious history of India, consider the following statements. Statement number 1, Sautrantika and Samitiya were sects of Jainism. Statement number 2, Sarvasti Vadin held the constituents of phenomena were not wholly momentary but existed forever in a latent form. Which of the following statements given above is or are correct? A. 1 only, B. 2 only, C. Both 1 and 2, and D. Neither 1 nor 2. Now before answering that question, let's have a look at some of the facts. So Sarvasti Vadin is a sect of Buddhism who believe in a complex system in which past, present and future phenomena are all held to have some form of their own existence, right? So they believe in past, present and future. And when we come to Sautrantika, which is again sect of Buddhism, so it is an early Buddhist school which believed that there are many Buddhas simultaneously, and the Sautrantika differed from their parent school Sarvasti Vadins, because unlike Sarvasti Vadins, they believe that only the present moment existed, whereas Sarvasti Vadins believe that there is a simultaneous existence of past, present and future, right? So this was the difference between Sarvasti Vadins and Sautrantikas. Both were the sects of Buddhism, right? And the Sautrantika school rejected the status of Abhidhamma as being Buddha Vachan, the word of Buddha. They held that it was work of different monks after his death, right? So what is Abhidhamma we are talking about here? Abhidhamma is actually one of the three pitikas. There are three pitikas in Buddhism, the three holy books, the Sutta Pitak, which is a collection of Buddha's sermons and teachings, the Vinaya Pitak, which deals with governing rules of Sanghas and the monks, and the third one is Abhidhamma Pitak, which contains the philosophy of the Buddhist teachings. It is an explanation of the Sutta Pitak actually. So Atlantikas do not believe that the sutras which are there in Abhidhamma are actually the words of Buddha himself. They say that those are the ideas of his successors, right? So this is the difference between Sarvastivadins and Sautrantika. Now let's come back to the question. So the statement number one says Sautrantika and Samitya were sects of Jainism. The statement is incorrect. Both are the sects of Buddhism. The statement number two is Sarvastivadin held that constituents of phenomena were not wholly momentary but existed forever in a latent form. The statement is correct. So past, present and future all exist simultaneously. So this statement is correct. So the correct option here is B, two only. Now let's come to question number three. Mediterranean Sea is a border of which of the following countries? 1. Jordan, 2. Iraq, 3. Lebanon and 4. Syria. Select the correct answer using the code given below. Now before answering the question, let's have a look at the map of the Mediterranean Sea region. So here we have the countries like Turkey, Syria, Lebanon, Israel, even Egypt, Libya. All these countries are sharing its border with the Mediterranean Sea. And the countries like Jordan, Iraq, which is further on the eastern side, all these countries do not share the border with Mediterranean Sea. So let's come back to the question now. So option one, Jordan is incorrect. It is a landlocked country. Even Iraq does not share a border with Mediterranean Sea. The correct answer is Lebanon and Syria. So the correct option here is C, 3 and 4 only, right? Now coming to question number 5, with reference to National Investment and Infrastructure Fund, which of the following statements is or are correct? Statement number 1, it is an organ of Niti Aayog. Statement number 2, it has a corpus of 4 lakh crore at present. Select the correct answer using the code given below. So before answering the question, let's have a quick glance at some of the details about NIIF. So NIIF, which is National Investment and Infrastructure Fund, it is a fund created by the Government of India for enhancing infrastructure financing in the country, and it was proposed in the Union Budget 2015, right? But it was set up in December 2015 with a targeted corpus of 40,000 crore. So this is the targeted corpus of the fund, and the purpose of the fund is that it will act like a fund of funds. So it will be So the government and the private players, they will be investing in NIIF, and NIIF further, it will be investing in the infrastructure companies like IRFC, Indian Rail Finance Corporation and National Housing Board, all these entities. Further, these agencies will be financing the infrastructure projects, right? So that is how it is acting like a fund of funds. But the irony of the situation is that it was in news recently because it has not made a single investment in any project, and it was set up with a targeted corpus of 40,000, but it has not received a single investment from any private player. Government has invested somewhere around 49% in it, but it is not successful till now. So now let's come back to the question. The statement one is, it is an organ of Niti Aayog. The statement is incorrect. Statement number 2, it has a corpus of 4 lakh crore at present. This is also incorrect. The targeted corpus is 40,000 crore, and out of which only 50% is contributed by the government, and it has not received a single investment from the private entities. So the correct answer here is D, neither 1 nor 2. Okay. Now let's come to question number 6. The global infrastructure facility is A, ASEAN facility to upgrade infrastructure in Asia and financed by credit from Asian Development Bank. B, World Bank collaboration that facilitates the preparation and structuring of complex infrastructure public-private partnerships to enable mobilization of private sector and institutional investor capital. C, collaboration among the major banks of the world working with the OECD and focused on expanding the set of infrastructure projects that have the potential to mobilize private investment. D, UNCTAD funded initiative that seeks to finance and facilitate infrastructure development in the world. Now before answering the question, let's have a look at some of the important points about Global Infrastructure Facility. So Global Infrastructure Facility is actually an initiative of the World Bank to channel the money towards infrastructure projects in developing countries, right? And the motto here is a partnership platform for greater investment in the infrastructure of emerging markets and developing economies. And its key focus will be on climate-friendly infrastructure investments and projects that will boost trade. And GIF provides comprehensive project support, starting from financing, supervision, implementation of the project and all those things, right? Now let's go back to the question. So option A says ASEAN initiative. This is not an ASEAN initiative. So coming to option B, World Bank collaboration that facilitates. Yes, it is a World Bank collaboration that facilitates the preparation and structuring of the complex infrastructure private-public partnerships. Yes, to enable mobilization of private sector and institutional investor capitals. So option B is correct, right? Now let's come to question number 7. For election to Lok Sabha, a nomination paper can be filed by A, anyone residing in India, B, a resident of constituency from which the election is to be contested, C, any citizen of India whose name appears in the electoral roll of the constituency, and D, any citizen of India. So the correct answer here is C. Any citizen of India whose name appears in the electoral roll of a constituency, right? So he should be registered as an elector. Then only he can file a nomination paper for Lok Sabha elections, right? So this is a simple question from the polity section. And these are qualifications which are defined by the constitution for elections to Lok Sabha. The person must be a citizen of India. He must not be less than 25 years of age. Must be registered as an elector in a parliamentary constituency. Okay. Now let's come to question number 8. Consider the following statements. 1. In India, the Himalayas are spread over 5 states only. 2. Western Ghats are spread over 5 states only. 3. Pulikat Lake is separated over 2 states only. Which of the statements given above is or are correct? A. 1 and 2 only. B. 3 only. C. 2 and 3 only. And D. 1 and 3 only. So statement 1 here is not correct, because in India, Himalayas are spread over Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal, Uttarakhand, Sikkim, Assam, West Bengal, Arunachal Pradesh. So 7 states, right? Not only 5 states. So this statement is incorrect. And Western Ghats are spread over 5 states only. This is also not correct, because there are 6 states, not 5 states. You have Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, then Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu, right? These are the 6 states. So even this statement is incorrect. Now coming to the third statement, Pulikat Lake is spread over 2 states only. This statement is correct, because Pulikat Lake is actually spread over 2 states, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. So the correct answer here is B, 3 only. Okay. And this is where the Pulikat Lake is located. This is the border between Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh. And the lake Pulikat is actually spread over the 2 states. It is shared by the 2 states, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. And there's an important ISRO installation here in Sriharikota, the satellite launch center. And Pulikat Lake is actually the second largest saltwater lake in India after Chilka Lake, which is in Odisha. And it is very famous for migratory birds. Okay. Coming to question number 9, biological oxygen demand is standard criteria for A. Measuring oxygen levels in blood, B. Computing oxygen levels in forest ecosystems, C. Pollution assay in aquatic ecosystems, and D. Assessing oxygen levels in high altitude regions. If you have prepared sincerely, this is not a difficult question at all, right? So correct answer here is C. Pollution assay in aquatic ecosystems. So biological oxygen demand is actually the amount of dissolved oxygen which is required by the aerobic biological organisms in that aquatic ecosystem to break down organic material present in the given water sample. So how do we gauge the level of pollution with the help of BOD? If the BOD increases, if there is high biological oxygen demand, then the pollution level in that water body is very high. So that is how BOD is actually an indicator of pollution in aquatic ecosystems. Now coming to question number 10, with reference to the role of UN Habitat in United Nations program working towards a better urban future, which of the following statements is or are correct? 1. UN Habitat has been mandated by the United Nations General Assembly to promote socially and environmentally sustainable towns and cities to provide adequate shelter for all. Statement number 2, its partners are either governments or local urban authorities only. So these statements which end with only are actually very doubtful statements. You should become alert once you read the statements ending with only. They are in most of the cases incorrect. Okay. Statement number 3, UN Habitat contributes to the overall objective of the United Nations system to reduce poverty and to promote access to safe drinking water and basic sanitation. Select the correct answer using code given below. Now before going to the answer, let's have a look at UN Habitat program of UN. The mission of UN Habitat program is to promote socially and environmentally sustainable human settlements and the achievement of adequate shelter for all. It was established in the year 1978 and it is a UN body, and it works to ensure the cities become more inclusive and affordable, and they become drivers of economic growth and social development. And the motto here is for a better urban future. Now let's come back to the question. Statement number 1 is UN Habitat has been mandated by United Nations General Assembly to promote socially and environmentally sustainable towns and cities to provide adequate shelter for all. The statement is correct. Statement number 2, its partners are either governments or local urban authorities only. This statement is incorrect, because such an agency, why would it restrict itself to the governments or the local authorities only? Why will it not partner with the NGOs, trade unions, professionals, academics? Right, all these people. So this statement is incorrect. Statement number 3 is UN Habitat contributes to overall objective of United Nations systems to reduce poverty and promote access to safe drinking water and basic sanitation. This statement is correct. So the correct answer here is B, 1 and 3 only. Now let's come to question number 11. With reference to National Skills Qualification Framework, NSQF, which of the following statements given below is or are correct? Statement number 1 is under NSQF, a learner can acquire the certification of competency only through formal learning. Again, the word only through formal learning, right? Statement number two, an outcome expected from the implementation of NSQF is the mobility between vocational and general education. Select the correct answer using the code given below. Now, before going to the answer, let's have a look at some important points about NSQF. NSQF is National Skill Qualification Framework. It is a competency-based framework that organizes all the qualifications according to a series of levels of knowledge, skill, and aptitude. So the problem with India is that only 2% of the workers have formally obtained skill training, right? So other people have learned something by their experience, right? They have not gone to an institution and acquired a certificate from there. So their employability remains low despite being increasing demand for the skilled labor in the labor market. They have the skills, but they do not have a document to prove they are skilled labor, right? So what the government is doing here is they have categorized the skill levels in 10 categories, and after conducting a test, they will issue this certificate. So the people who have acquired some skills based on their experience and they have not gone to any training institute or something like that, they can acquire the certificate and then they can improve their employability. So that is the whole idea here. And NSQF in India was notified on 27 December 2013, and its objectives are to recognize the prior learning, and it allows the transition from informal to organized job market by providing this kind of certificate which can improve their employability. And it is universally acceptable skill quality assurance framework. So this is a way to integrate the labor market in India, and it will also help in global mobility of the skilled workforce from India. Now coming to the options, statement number one is, under NSQF, a learner can acquire the certification for competency only through formal learning. This statement is incorrect. It is giving recognition to prior learning. And statement number two is, an outcome expected from the implementation of NSQF is the mobility between the vocational and general education. Right, that is correct. It is bridging a gap between education and the vocational sector. So the second statement is correct. So the correct option here is option B, two only, right? Now let's come to question number 12. In the context of Indian history, the principle of diarchy refers to A, division of the central legislature into two houses; B, introduction of double government, that is central government and the state government; C, having two sets of ruler, one in London and another in Delhi; and D, division of subjects delegated to the provinces into two categories. So the correct answer here is D, division of subjects delegated to provinces in two categories. Division of the central legislature into two houses is bicameralism. A lot of people got confused in this option. So bicameralism means that you have upper house and lower house, you have Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha, right? But diarchy is not that. Diarchy was introduced in Government of India Act 1919, which is also known as Montagu-Chelmsford reforms or Montford reforms. So what happened here was the provincial subjects were further subdivided into two categories, transferred and reserved. So this division of the subjects into two categories was actually termed as diarchy, right? Now let's come to question number 13. Consider the following in respect of National Career Service. Statement number one, National Career Service is an initiative of Department of Personnel and Training, Government of India. Statement number two, National Career Service has been launched in a mission mode to improve the employment opportunities to uneducated youth of the country. Which of the following statements is or are correct? Let's have a look at National Career Service before going to the options. So it is an initiative of the Ministry of Labour and Employment, which was launched in July 2015, and it is a part of government's focus on providing right skills and generating employment. So now we have seen two questions from Skill India Mission. That is why the government policies are very, very important. You should go through all the latest government policies in detail. Okay. And it will serve as a platform for addressing all career related needs of the youth and students who are seeking counseling or job search. So earlier we were having these employment exchange in the districts and the cities. Now this is a advanced version of that, we can say. Now let's come to the options. Statement number one, National Career Service is an initiative of Department of Personnel and Training. No, this statement is incorrect. It is an initiative of Ministry of Labor and Employment. Okay. Statement number two, National Career Service has been launched in a mission mode to improve the employment opportunities to uneducated youth of the country. This statement is correct, right? So the correct answer here is B, two only. Now let's come to question number 14. Which of the following statements best describe the term Scheme for Sustainable Structuring of Stressed Assets, S4A, recently seen in the news? So if you have gone through our lectures on economic survey, you would have come across the explanation of S4A. We have covered that in detail. So before going to the options, let's have a look at these statements. So there were some steps taken to tackle the non-performing asset issue, right? The steps taken by the government in the recent past were asset reconstruction companies, and they were expected to buy the loans from the stressed banks and to recover the loans on their behalf. But this had a limited success because only 5% of the NPAs were overtaken by the ARCs, because even ARCs did not want to take too much risk. Then the government came up with another strategy called strategic debt reconstruction, where the creditors, the people who have given loan to these entities, could take over the firm which were unable to pay and sell them to the new owners in a hope that they will make it profitable. But even this was unsuccessful because the large firms, which are the main culprits, had actually taken loans from different entities, and to bring everyone on board and to, you know, have a consensus and decide to sell the firm to a particular person was very, very difficult. Right, so even this was not successful. So government came with another scheme called sustainable structuring of stressed assets, where the creditors, the people who have given the loan to the company, these creditors could provide firms with the debt reductions of up to 50% in order to restore their financial viability. So the creditors here were given power to reduce the debt liability by 50%, right? So they can straight away write off 50% of the debt to improve the financial viability of the firm. But even this thing was not very successful. Now let's come back to the options. Statement one is, it is a procedure for considering ecological cost of development schemes formulated by the government. Statement is incorrect. It is a scheme of RBI for reworking the financial structure of big corporate entities facing genuine difficulties. This statement is correct. Correct answer here is B. Let's come to question number 15. Consider the following statements. 1. Climate and Clean Air Coalition, CCAC, to reduce short-lived climate pollutants is a unique initiative of G20 group of countries. Statement number 2. CCAC focuses on methane, black carbon and hydrofluorocarbons. Which of the statements given above is or are correct? Now, before answering the question, let's have a look at CCAC. Climate and Clean Air Coalition, CCAC, to reduce short-lived climate pollutants. It was launched by United Nations Environment Programme, UNEP, and 6 countries, Bangladesh, Canada, Ghana, Mexico, Sweden, and the US on 16 February 2012. And what are short-lived climate pollutants, SLCPs? These are the agents that have relatively short lifetime in the atmosphere, ranging from a few days to a few decades, and a warming influence on the climate. The main short-lived climate pollutants are black carbon, methane, tropospheric ozone, etc. Okay, now let's come back to the question. So statement one is incorrect because it is not an initiative of G20 group of countries. It is an initiative of UNEP plus 6 countries. Okay. And statement number 2 is correct because CCAC focuses on methane, black carbon and hydrofluorocarbons. So the correct answer here is B, 2 only. Now let's come to question number 16. With reference to Indian Ocean Dipole, IOD, sometimes mentioned in the news while forecasting Indian monsoon, which of the following statements is or are correct? 1. IOD phenomena is characterized by a difference in sea surface temperature between tropical western Indian Ocean and tropical east Pacific Ocean. Statement 1 is incorrect, because Indian Ocean Dipole is an irregular oscillation of the sea surface temperature in which the western Indian Ocean becomes alternatively warmer and then colder than the eastern part of the ocean. Okay, so statement 1 is incorrect. Statement number 2 is, an IOD phenomena can influence an El Nino's impact on monsoon. This statement is correct, because IOD phenomena can either strengthen the impact of El Nino or it can weaken it, right? So the correct answer here is B, 2 only. Now let's come to question number 17. If you want to see ghadials in their natural habitat, which one of the following is the best place to visit? A. Bhitarkanika mangroves, B. Chambal river, C. Pulikat lake and D. Dipor Bil. So a lot of people have done a mistake. They have put Bhitarkanika mangroves, which is incorrect, because Bhitarkanika mangrove is famous for crocodiles, not ghadials. And there is a difference between ghadials and crocodiles. Okay. The correct answer is Chambal river. Right, there is a national Chambal sanctuary which is famous for these ghadials. So the correct answer here is B, Chambal river. Right, let's come to question number 18. Consider the following in respect of Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, IONS. Statement number 1. Inaugural IONS was held in India in 2015 under the chairmanship of Indian Navy. Statement number 2. IONS is a voluntary initiative that seeks to increase maritime cooperation among navies of littoral states of Indian Ocean region. Which of the following statements is or are correct? So statement 1 is incorrect here, because inaugural IONS was not held in India in 2015. It was inaugurated in 2008, yes, under the chairmanship of Indian Navy, but in the year 2008, not 2015, right? And IONS is a voluntary initiative that seeks to increase maritime cooperation among the navies of littoral states of the Indian Ocean region. This statement is correct. So the correct answer here is B, 2 only, right? Now let's come to question number 19. The painting of Bodhisattva Padmapani is one of the famous and the oft illustrated paintings at A. Ajanta, B. Badami, C, Bagh, and D, Ellora. And the correct answer here is A, Ajanta. And this is the painting they are talking about. This is a very famous painting of a bodhisattva called Padmapani. Now let's come to question number 20. Consider the following pairs of traditions and communities. First pair is Chaliha Sahib Festival and the community is Sindhi. Second pair is Nand Raj Jat Yatra and the community is Gond. And the statement 3 is Wari Warkari and the community is Santhal. Which of the pairs given above is or are correctly matched? Pair 1 is correctly matched. Chaliha Sahib is actually a festival of Sindhis. So this we will consider as a little difficult question from art and culture series, right? And coming to the second pair, Nand Raj Jat Yatra of the Gond community. This statement is incorrect because the Gonds are not associated with this, and even the statement number 3 is incorrect. So the correct answer here is A1 only. Chaliha Sahib, this is a festival of Sindhis. And Nand Raj Jat Yatra is observed in the Kumaon region of Uttarakhand. And Wari Warkari is an annual procession which is observed in the Pandharpur region of Maharashtra. Now let's come to question number 21. Which of the following practices can help in water conservation in agriculture? 1. Reduced or zero tillage of land. 2. Applying gypsum before irrigating the field. 3. Allowing crop residue to remain in the field. Select the correct answer using the code given below. And the correct answer here is D, 1, 2 and 3. All the statements are correct. So here you can see the difference between no-till land and the conventional land. So the water retention capability and the productivity of the no-till land is higher than the tilled land. And in the image on the right hand side, you can see that there is a yellow line, and the land on the left side of the yellow line is actually treated with gypsum, and on the right side it is untreated. So you can see waterlogging in this region, whereas this part of the land is dry. So that means the water retention capability of the gypsum treated soil increases. So that is why it also helps in water conservation, right? Now let's come to question number 22. Consider the following statements. The nationwide soil health card scheme aims at 1. Expanding the cultivable area under irrigation. 2. Enabling the banks to assess the quantum of loans to be granted to farmers on the basis of soil quality. 3. Checking the overuse of fertilizers in the farmlands. Which of the following statements is or are correct? So this question is on soil health card scheme. The scheme has a motto, Swasth Dhara Khet Hara. So this government scheme, soil health card scheme, was launched by the central government in February 2015. And under this scheme, soil health cards will be issued to the farmers, and that card will carry the crop-wise recommendations of the nutrients and fertilizers which are required for individual farms. And this will help the farmers to improve their productivity through the judicious use of inputs, right? So because presently they are not knowing in what proportion they have to put the fertilizers and pesticides and all those things, right? So this will give a scientific recommendation to the farmers based on the scientific assessment of the quality of their soil, okay? So statement number 1, expanding the cultivable area under irrigation. This is incorrect. Number 2, enabling the banks to assess the quantum of loans to be granted to the farmers on the basis of the soil quality. Even this is incorrect. Statement number 3, checking the overuse of fertilizers in the farmlands. This statement is correct. The correct answer is B, 3 only. Only the third statement is correct. Okay. Now let's come to question number 23. Consider the following pairs. Commonly used material versus unwanted or controversial chemicals found in them. Statement number 1, lipstick, lead. 2. Soft drinks, brominated vegetable oils. 3. Chinese fast food, monosodium glutamate. Which of the pairs given above is or are correctly matched? So lead is a common impurity found in the cosmetic lip products such as lipstick and other cosmetics. So the statement 1 is correct. And brominated vegetable oil is also used as a food additive sometimes. And Chinese fast food does contain monosodium glutamate. This is the same chemical which came into limelight 2 years back when there was controversy around Maggi. Right, so this was the chemical which was found in excess quantity in Maggi. So the correct answer here is D, 1, 2 and 3. All the pairs are correctly matched. Now let's come to question number 24. Organic LEDs, organic light emitting diodes, are used to create digital displays on many devices. What are the advantages of OLED displays over liquid crystal displays? So statement 1 is OLED displays can be fabricated on flexible plastic substrates. The statement is correct. Statement number 2, roll-up displays embedded in clothing can be made using OLEDs. Even statement number 2 is correct. Transparent displays are possible using OLEDs. The statement 3 is also correct. So correct answer here is C, 1, 2 and 3. Question number 25, which of the following is or are famous for sun temples? 1. Arasavalli. 2. Amarkantak. 3. Omkareshwar. Select the correct answer using the code given below. So the correct answer is A, 1 only. Arsavalli has a sun temple. There is no sun temple in Amarkantak or Omkareshwar. And this is a photograph of the entrance of Suryanarayan Swami, god of Arsavalli, in the Srikakulam district of Andhra Pradesh, sitting on the chariot of 7 horses. All right. Let's come to question number 26. Consider the following statements. Statement number 1. In the election of Lok Sabha or State Assembly, the winning candidate must get at least 50% of the votes polled to be declared elected. Statement number 2. According to the provisions laid down in the Constitution of India, in Lok Sabha, the Speaker's post goes to the majority party and the Deputy Speaker's to the opposition. Which of the following statements given above is or are correct? Statement 1 is incorrect. In the election for Lok Sabha or the State Assembly, the winning candidate must get at least 50% of the votes polled to be declared elected. No, there's no requirement of the majority or the 50% votes, because we follow the first past the post system. So whoever gets the maximum of number of votes will be the winning candidate. Right. So this statement is incorrect. Coming to statement number 2, according to the provisions laid down in the Constitution of India, in Lok Sabha, the Speaker's post goes to the majority party and the Deputy Speaker's to the opposition. There's no rule like that. So the correct answer here is D, neither 1 nor 2. Now coming to question number 27, which of the following has or have occurred in India after its liberalization of economic policies in 1991? Statement number 1, share of agriculture in GDP increased enormously. This is incorrect. Share of agriculture in the GDP is actually decreasing. Then coming to statement number 2, share of India's exports in the world trade increased. Yeah, that is right. And FDI flows increased. Even this is correct. India's foreign exchange reserve increased enormously. Yeah, that is also right. So the correct answer here is B, 2, 3 and 4 only. And this is a graph showing the sector-wise contribution of GDP over the period of years. So here from 1950 to 2010, this is the trend. The contribution of service sector in the GDP is increasing and the contribution of agriculture is coming down, right? From 50% in 1950 to 14% in 2010-11, right? Now coming to question number 28, what is the application of somatic cell nuclear transfer technology? A, production of biolarvicides. B, manufacture of biodegradable plastics. C, reproductive cloning of animals. And D, production of organisms free of diseases. So this is the somatic cell nuclear transfer technology they are talking about. So this is used in the process of cloning. So what happens here is, this is the animal which is to be cloned. Okay, so the cells from its body are taken and the nucleus is removed, and that nucleus is actually put in the egg which is taken from another donor of the same species, right? So the egg is something like this. The egg cell or the casing is from the donor and the nucleus is from the animal which is to be cloned, right? So this combination is put in lab for around 7 days and then it is implanted in the surrogate mother. And after the incubation period, the cloned animal is born. So the correct answer here is C, reproductive cloning of animals. So this is what somatic cell nuclear transfer technology is. Let's go to question number 29. Consider the following statements. Statement number 1, National Payments Corporation of India, NPCI, helps in promoting the financial inclusion in the country. The statement is correct. National Payment Corporation India, which is responsible for creating RuPay, Bheem app and all those things, right? Statement number 2, NPCI has launched RuPay, a card payment scheme. Which of the following statements is or are correct? The correct answer is C, both 1 and 2. So NPCI was in news frequently after demonetization because of the growing digital payments and all those things. So that is why it is in the question paper also, right? Now coming to question number 30, the term M stripes is sometimes seen in the news in the context of A, captive breeding of wild fauna, B, maintenance of tiger reserves, C, indigenous satellite navigation system, and D, security of national highways. The correct answer here is B, maintenance of tiger reserves. The full form of M stripe is actually monitoring system for tigers, intensive protection and ecological status. It is a software monitoring system which is launched by Government of India in 2010 in some of the tiger reserves to reduce the vulnerability of the tiger. So it will help the field managers and the forest officers to improve their coverage of the patrols with the help of a GIS system. Now let's come to question number 31. Which of the following is the most likely advantages of implementing GST? Statement number 1, it will replace multiple taxes collected by multiple authorities and will thus create a single market in India. This is correct. It will drastically reduce the current account deficit of India and will enable to increase its foreign exchange reserves. This is not a direct impact. It will enormously increase the growth and size of the economy of India and it will enable it to overtake China in the near future. Even this is not going to happen suddenly because of GST. Select the correct answer using the code given below. So correct answer here is A, 1 only. Now let's come to question number 32. Broad-based trade and investment agreement BTIA is sometimes seen in the news in the context of the negotiations held between India and A, European Union, B, Gulf Cooperation Council, C. Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD. D. Shanghai Cooperation Organization, SCO. The correct answer here is A. European Union. So BTIA is actually a free trade agreement which is proposed between EU and India, and the talks are going on, but it is in deadlock since 2013 after 16 rounds of negotiation, right? Now let's come to question number 33. Consider the following statement. Statement number 1, India has ratified the Trade Facilitation Agreement TFA of World Trade Organization. Statement number 2, TFA is a part of WTO's Bali Ministerial Package of 2013. Statement number 3, TFA came into force in January 2016. Which of the following statements given is or are correct? Now before going to the options, let's have a look at TFA, Trade Facilitation Agreement. So it is actually an initiative to standardize the customs procedure across the country so that the movement of goods can be facilitated. Okay. And the aim is to ease and boost international trade. And it was an outcome of WTO's 9th Bali Ministerial Package in 2013, which was held in Bali, Indonesia. And India has ratified it in April 2016. That is why it was in news. So the correct answer here is A, 1 and 2 only. The third statement is not correct. The TFA came into force in January 2016. No, it came into force in Feb 2017, right? Now let's come to question number 34. What is the importance of developing Chabahar port by India? A, India's trade with African countries will enormously increase. No. B, India's relation with oil producing Arab countries will be strengthened. Not that much. C, India will not depend on Pakistan for access to Afghanistan and Central Asia. So statement C is correct. So correct answer here is statement number C. So let's have a look at the Chabahar project. So Chabahar port is actually located in Iran and it is being developed with the help of India. So this port will actually be helping us to reach Iran and other Central Asian countries through the sea route, and we can avoid Pakistan in between. In the vicinity is actually Gwadar port, which is being developed in Pakistan with the help of China, right? And these two ports are just at a distance of 72 kilometers. So that is the strategic importance of Chabahar port for India. Now let's come to question number 35. In India, it is legally mandatory for which of the following to report a cyber security incident? 1. Service providers. 2. Data centers. 3. Body corporate. Select the correct answer using the code given below. The correct answer here is D, 1, 2 and 3. Let's come to question number 36. Right to vote and to be elected in India is of A, fundamental right, B, natural right, C, constitutional right, or D, legal right. The correct answer here is D, legal right. Okay. Now let's come to question number 37. What is the purpose of Evolved Laser Interferometer Space Antenna, ELISA project? A, to detect neutrinos. B, to detect gravitational waves. C, to detect effectiveness of missile defense system. And D, to study the effect of solar flares on our communication system. The correct answer is B, to detect gravitational waves. So this is what the project is. ELISA is Evolved Laser Interferometer Space Antenna. And it was launched in 2015 by NASA, and it is launched to detect the gravitational waves. There are three spacecrafts in a triangular formation, okay, which will be in the space. And this is actually an interferometer in the space. Now let's come to question number 38. What is the purpose of Vidyanjali project? Statement number 1, to enable the famous foreign educational institutions to open their campuses in India. Statement number 2, to increase the quality of education provided in government schools by taking help from private sector and community. Statement number 3, to encourage voluntary monetary contributions from private individuals and organizations so as to improve the infrastructure facilities for primary and secondary schools. Select the correct answer using the codes given below. The correct answer here is A, 2 only. The aim is to increase the quality of education provided in the government schools by taking help from private sector and the community, right? So let's see what is the scheme all about. So Vidyanjali Yojana is actually launched by Ministry of HRD, Human Resource Development, and it is launched in order to boost education sector in India by delivering voluntary teaching to government schools, and anyone can join this program. There's no need of a teaching certificate, and here the community power is being utilized to bring about educational upliftment, and this is a perfect match for someone who is looking for an avenue to give back to the society and someone who is lagging in privileges, right? So Vidyanjali program is actually bringing these people together. Okay, so the correct answer here is 2, to increase the quality of education provided in government schools by taking help from private sector and the community. So let's come to question number 39. What is the aim of program Unnat Bharat Abhiyan? A, achieving 100% literacy by promoting collaboration between voluntary organizations and government's education system and local communities. B, connecting institutions of higher education with local communities to address development challenges through appropriate technologies. C, strengthening India's scientific research institutions in order to make India a scientific and technological power. And D, developing human capital by allocating special funds for healthcare and education for rural and urban poor, and organizing skill development programs and vocational training for them. The correct answer here is B. Connecting institutions of higher education with local communities to address development challenges through appropriate technologies. So that is the aim of Unnat Bharat Abhiyan. So it envisages that institutes of higher learning would be connected to the villages, and it is aiming to involve the professionals and other higher educational institutions of the country in process of indigenous development of self-sufficient and sustainable villages in tune with the notion of Gram Swaraj propounded by Mahatma Gandhi. And there are 132 villages which are identified, and 16 IITs are being linked to these 132 villages, and these institutions of higher studies will be solving some practical problems of these 132 villages, right? So that is all about Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, a project of Ministry of HRD. Now let's come to question number 40. Consider the following statements. Statement number 1, Election Commission of India is a 5-member body. Statement 1 is incorrect. It is a 3-member body. There is a Chief Election Commissioner and there are 2 Election Commissioners. Statement number 2, Union Ministry of Home Affairs decides the election schedule for the conduct of both general elections and by-elections. The statement is incorrect. The schedule is fixed by the Election Commission. Statement number 3, Election Commission resolves the disputes relating to splits, merges of recognized political parties. The statement 3 is correct. So the correct answer here is D, 3 only. Now let's come to question number 41. In India, if a species of tortoise is declared protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act 1972, what does it imply? A. It enjoys the same level of protection as tiger. B. It no longer exists in the wild. A few individuals are under captive protection and now it is impossible to prevent its extinction. C. It is endemic to a particular region of India. And D. Both B and C stated above are correct in this context. The correct answer here is A. It enjoys the same level of protection as tiger. Okay, so tiger is an animal in the Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act 1972. So if tortoise becomes a part of the Schedule 1, it will enjoy the same privileges as tiger enjoys. Now let's come to question number 42. In India, judicial review implies A. The power of judiciary to pronounce upon the constitutionality of laws and executive orders. The power of judiciary to question the wisdom of the laws enacted by the legislatures. C. The power of judiciary to review all the legislative enactments before they are assented by the president. No, it is not reviewing all the legislative enactments. D. The power of judiciary is to review its own judgments given earlier in similar or different cases. So the correct answer here is statement A. The power of the judiciary to pronounce upon the constitutionality of the laws and executive orders, right? So it can test the constitutionality of both the laws and executive orders, right? Now let's come to question number 43. With reference to Indian freedom struggle, consider the following events. 1. Mutiny in Royal Indian Navy. 2. Quit India movement launched. 3. Second roundtable conference. What is the correct chronological sequence of the above events? The correct answer here is C, 3, 2 and 1. Roundtable conference took place from 1930 to 1932 after Simon Commission report. Right. And what was the result of the roundtable conference? Government of India Act 1935. Right. And Quit India movement was launched in 1942. So this is the chronological sequence 3, 2 and 1. So option C is the correct answer. Now coming to question number 44, consider the following statements. Statement number 1, tax revenue as a percentage of GDP of India has steadily increased in the last decade. Statement number 2, fiscal deficit as a percentage of GDP of India has steadily increased in the last decade. Which of the following statements given above is or are correct? The correct answer here is D, neither 1 nor 2. The tax revenue as a percentage of GDP of India has not steadily increased in the last decade, and the fiscal deficit as a percentage of GDP of India has also not steadily increased in the last decade. So these are the figures of fiscal deficit as a percentage of GDP. It is coming down gradually, right? It is not increasing. And tax revenue as a percentage of GDP, it increased till 2008 and then it came down and further it is increasing. So there is no steady trend. That is why both the statements are incorrect. Let's come to question number 45. Recently, there was a proposal to translocate some of the lions from their natural habitat in Gujarat to which one of the following sites? So this is just a pure cheeky kind of question. The correct answer here is B. Kuno Palpur Wildlife Sanctuary. It is located in Madhya Pradesh. Okay, here. And the lions from Gir National Park were planned to be shifted to Kuno Wildlife Sanctuary. Okay. Let's come to question number 46. Which of the following are not necessarily the consequence of proclamation of president's rule in a state? 1. Dissolution of the state legislative assembly. 2. Removal of council of ministers in the state. 3. Dissolution of the local bodies. Select the correct answer using the code given below. The correct answer here is B, 1 and 3 only. Question number 47. Which of the following are envisaged by the right against exploitation in the Constitution of India? 1. Prohibition of trafficking in human beings and forced labor. 2. Abolition of untouchability. 3. Protection of interest of minorities. 4. Prohibition of employment of children in factories and mines. So what is the correct answer here? So there is a right against exploitation, which is a fundamental right in the Constitution of India. And it talks about two provisions, prohibition of trafficking in human beings and forced labor, Article 23, and prohibition of employment of children in factories and mines, that is Article 24. Statement number 2 and 3 are not a part of right against exploitation in the Constitution of India. So the correct answer here is C, 1 and 4 only. Okay, let's come to question number 48. Which of the following is geographically closest to Great Nicobar? A. Sumatra, B. Borneo, C. Java, and D. Sri Lanka. Borneo, Sumatra, Java are actually the islands of Indonesia. So which of the following is geographically closest to the Great Nicobar? Before answering the question, let's have a look at the map. So this is the map, and Great Nicobar we have somewhere here, and we have Sumatra, Java, and Borneo here, right? And Sri Lanka is here. So which is the nearest? Sumatra is nearest to Great Nicobar. So the correct answer here is A, Sumatra. Okay. Let's come to question number 49. Out of the following statements, choose the one that brings out the principle of underlying the cabinet form of government. A, an arrangement of minimizing the criticism against government whose responsibilities are complex and hard to carry out to satisfaction of all. B, a mechanism for speeding up the activities of the government whose responsibilities are increasing day by day. No. These two statements are incorrect. C, a mechanism of parliamentary democracy for ensuring collective responsibility of the government to the people. This is the correct statement. The statement C is the answer here. Okay, because cabinet takes collective decisions and it ensures collective responsibility of the government in that way. And in presidential democracies like USA, cabinet does not function as a collective legislative influence. Rather, their role is advisory in nature. The president of USA has full freedom to not act as per the advice of the cabinet. But in the case of parliamentary democracies like UK and India, the cabinet collectively decides the government's direction, right? Now let's come to question number 50. Which one of the following is not a feature of Indian federalism? A, there is an independent judiciary in India. That is right. It is a part of Indian federalism. B, powers have been clearly divided between center and the state. This is also correct. There is 7th schedule in this constitution which has center list, state list and the concurrent list. So the powers are clearly divided. C, the federating units have been given unequal representation in the Rajya Sabha. Yes, based on their population. D, it is the result of the agreement among the federating units. No, it is not like that. This system is followed in US but not in India. The Constitution of India establishes a federal system of the government, and the term federation is nowhere used in the Constitution. Article 1 on the other hand describes India as a union of the states. So India is not a federation. Actually, India is union of states according to the constitutions, because Indian federation is not a result of an agreement by the states, and no state has the right to go out of this federation, unlike USA. So let's come to question number 51. The objective of the Butler Committee of 1927 was to A, define the jurisdiction of the central and provincial governments. B, define the powers of the Secretary of State of India. C, impose censorship on national press. And D, improve the relationship between the government of India and the Indian states. And the correct answer here is D, to improve the relationship between government of India and the Indian states. So actually, during the British rule, there were two types of provinces. There were some of the provinces which were under the control of the British, and there were some princely states. So this committee was appointed under the chairmanship of Sir Harcourt Butler, and it was given the duty to recommend the type of relationship between the government of India and the Indian princely states. Okay, so the correct answer here is D. Now let's come to question number 52. The term domestic content requirement is sometimes seen in news with reference to A, developing solar power production in our country. B, granting licenses to foreign TV channels in our country. C, exporting our food products to other countries. And D, permitting foreign educational institutions to set up their campuses in our country. Okay, so the correct answer here is A, developing solar power production in our country. So domestic content requirement was actually one of the requirements which was mandated by the government of India with respect to its Jawaharlal Nehru National Solar Mission. So the condition of the government was that the solar panels which were to be supplied to implement this particular project should be originated from India. So this condition was actually put to promote the Indian industry working in the field of solar power production. Okay, but US raised an objection in World Trade Organization that this is anti-trade, right? This condition should be removed, and India has lost recently, and WTO has given a ruling against India, and it has set a deadline, and by December 2017 India should remove this clause from its procurement policy. Okay, now let's come to question number 53. Consider the following statements. Statement 1, nuclear security summits are periodically held under the aegis of United Nations. Statement number 2, the International Panel on Fissile Materials is an organ of International Atomic Energy Agency. Which of the following statements given above is or are correct? A. 1 only, B. 2 only, C. both 1 and 2, and D. neither 1 nor 2. And the correct answer here is D. neither 1 nor 2. Okay, so Nuclear Security Summit is actually held under the aegis of United States, not United Nations. And International Panel on Fissile Materials is not an organ of Atomic Energy Agency, IAEA. It is an independent body and a voluntary organization, right? That is why the correct answer here is neither one nor two. And these are the countries shown in green color, which are members of Nuclear Security Summit. And this is held under the leadership of United States, okay? Now let's come to question number 54. Who among the following can join the National Pension Scheme? This is a very factual question. Option A, resident Indian citizens only. This option is incorrect because it is open to the citizens who are non-resident, NRIs also. Statement B, persons of age from 21 to 55 only. This statement is incorrect because this is open for 18 to 60 years of age, right? All state government employees joining the service after the date of notification by the respective state governments. This statement is correct. All central government employees, including those of armed forces, joining the service on or after 1st April 2004. This statement is incorrect because personnel of armed forces cannot opt for this scheme because they have their own pension scheme, right? So the correct answer here is C. Let's come to question number 55. With reference to river Tista, consider the following statements. The source of the river Tista is the same as the Brahmaputra, but it flows through Sikkim. This statement is incorrect because the river Tista originates from Tibet only, but the source is different. The river Brahmaputra and Indus, they originate in the vicinity of Mansarovar Lake, but Tista does not originate near Lake Mansarovar. Its origin is in a region called Tista Kangse, which is a glacier, and it flows southward through Sikkim Himalaya. It flows through Sikkim and West Bengal and then enters Bangladesh, right? And statement number 2 is River Rangit originates in Sikkim and it is a tributary of River Tista. This statement is correct. Statement number 3, River Tista flows into Bay of Bengal on the border of India and Bangladesh. This statement is incorrect because Tista does not form a border between India and Bangladesh. It actually merges with Brahmaputra and meets into the sea through Bangladesh, right? So the correct answer here is B, 2 only. Only the second statement is correct. Let's come to question number 56. The question is, consider the following statements. Statement number 1, in tropical regions, Zika virus disease is transmitted by the same mosquito that transmits dengue. The statement is correct. Dengue is caused by the mosquito Aedes aegypti, and the same mosquito spreads Zika virus also. So statement 1 is correct. Statement number 2, sexual transmission of Zika virus disease is possible. This statement is correct because this can be transmitted through body fluids such as blood, semen, etc. So the correct option here is C, both 1 and 2. Both the statements are correct. Let's come to question number 57. Consider the following statements. Statement number 1, the standard mark of BIS, Bureau of Indian Standards, is mandatory for automotive tires and tubes. The statement is correct. BIS mark is required for these products. Statement number 2, EGMARK is a quality certification mark issued by Food and Agriculture Organization. This statement is incorrect. EGMARK is an Indian concept. You would have seen EGMARK on the food products. EGMARK is actually a certification mark employed on agriculture products in India, which assures that these products conform to some set of standards which are defined by the Directorate of Marketing and Inspection, Government of India, right? So this is an Indian standard. It does not have anything to do with Food and Agriculture Organization. So statement 2 is incorrect. So correct answer here is A, 1 only. Now question number 58. What is or are the advantage or advantages of implementing the National Agriculture Market? So National Agriculture Market was in news recently, that is why this question, right? There are a lot of questions on government schemes in this year's paper, so you should go through them very religiously, the important ones, right? The statement 1 is, it is a pan-India electronic trading portal for agricultural commodities. Statement is correct, right? So this is basically a web portal where the farmers and the buyers of agriculture commodities, the dealers, the wholesale dealers can connect with each other and they can buy and sell their produce. Statement 2, it provides farmers access to the nationwide market with prices commensurate with the quality of their produce, right? And this helps in integrating the Indian agricultural market nationwide, and farmers can get fair price for their produce. So this statement is also correct. So the correct option here is C, both 1 and 2. Now let's come to question number 59 with reference to National Intellectual Property Rights Policy. Consider the following statements. Statement number 1. It reiterates India's commitment to Doha Development Agenda and TRIPS Agreement. This statement is correct. Statement number 2, Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, DIP, is nodal agency for regulating intellectual property rights in India. Even this statement is correct, right? So the correct option here is C, both 1 and 2. Now let's come to question number 60. According to the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, which of the following animals cannot be hunted by any person except under some provisions provided by the law? 1. Ghadiyal, 2. Indian wild ass, and 3. Wild buffalo. Select the correct answer using the code given below. The correct answer is D, 1, 2, and 3. All the three are actually protected under the Wildlife Protection Act 1972. Now let's come to question number 61. Which of the following statements is or are true about the fundamental duties of Indian citizens? 1. A legislative process has been provided to enforce these duties. No, there is no legislative process to enforce these duties. So this statement is incorrect. They are correlative to legal duties. Even this statement is incorrect. They are not correlative to legal duties because there is no legal sanction against their violation. So the correct answer here is D, neither 1 nor 2. Both the statements are incorrect. Right? Now let's come to question number 62. Consider the following pairs. This is a pure GK type question. If you know it, you can answer. Otherwise, it is very difficult. So consider the following pairs. 1. Radhakant Deb, first president of British Indian Association. This statement is correct. 2. Gazulu Lakshmi Narasu Chetty, founder of Madras Mahajan Sabha. Statement is incorrect. Surendranath Banerjee was the founder of Indian Association. The statement is correct. So the correct answer here is B, 1 and 3 only. Let's come to question number 63. Which one of the following objectives is not embodied in the preamble of the Constitution of India? A. Liberty of thought. B. Economic liberty. C. Liberty of expression. D. Liberty of belief. The correct answer here is economic liberty. Because preamble secures to all citizens of India liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship through their fundamental rights enforceable in the court of law in case of violation, right? But there is no mention of economic liberty. So the correct answer is B, economic liberty. Now let's come to question number 64. With reference to Quality Council of India, consider the following statements. 1. Quality Council of India was set up jointly by Government of India and Indian industry. This statement is correct. QCI was set up jointly by the Government of India and the Indian industry, represented by three premier industry organizations that are ASSOCHAM, Associated Chambers of Commerce and Industry of India, CII, Confederation of Indian Industry, and FICCI, Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industries. That is how QCI was established. So statement 1 is correct. Statement number 2, the chairman of QCI is appointed by Prime Minister on the recommendations of the industry to the government. This statement is also correct. So the correct answer here is C, both 1 and 2. Now let's come to question number 65. What is the purpose of setting up small finance banks in India? 1. To supply credit to small business units. Yes, the statement is correct. Statement number 2. To supply credit to small and marginal farmers. Correct. Even farmers can avail small loans from these small finance banks. The name itself tells it is for small financing. Okay. Statement number 3. To encourage young entrepreneurs to set up business, particularly in rural areas. This is not one of the objectives of small finance bank. This statement is incorrect. So the correct answer here is A, 1 and 2 only. Okay, now let's come to question number 66. With reference to Asia Pacific Ministerial Conference on Housing and Urban Development, APMCHUD, consider the following statements. Statement number 1, the first APMCHUD was held in India in 2006 on the theme Emerging Urban Forms, Policy Responses and Governance Structure. This statement is incorrect because yes, first APMCHUD was held in New Delhi in 2006. That is correct, but the theme was not this. The theme was a vision for sustainable urbanization in the Asia Pacific by 2020, right? So this is why the statement one is incorrect. Coming to statement number 2, India hosts all the annual ministerial conferences in partnership with ADB, Asian Development Bank, APEC, Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation, and ASEAN, Association of Southeast Asian Nations. This statement is also incorrect, because these conferences are held in the member nations on a turn basis, one after the other. Now let's come to question number 67. Democracy's superior virtue lies in the fact that it calls into activity A. The intelligence of character of ordinary men and women. B. The methods for strengthening executive leadership. C. A superior individual with dynamism and vision. And D. A band of dedicated party workers. So what is the democracy's superior virtue? Where does it lie? So it lies in the fact that it calls into activity the intelligence and character of ordinary men and women. Okay, so the correct answer here is A. Right, now let's come to question number 68. Which of the following is the most likely consequence of implementing the Unified Payment Interface UPI? So this was also a hot topic in the news after the implementation of demonetization. There was another question we have seen regarding National Payment Corporation of India, NPCI, right? This is another question in that arena itself on digital payments. Which of the following is the most likely consequence of implementing the Unified Payment Interface? A. Mobile wallets will not be necessary for online payments. B. Digital currency will totally replace the physical currency in about 2 decades. This cannot be guaranteed that physical currency will completely go away. C. FDI inflows will drastically increase. No. Statement D. Direct transfer of subsidies to poor people will become very effective. Yes, this is partly correct, but the most appropriate option here is option A. Mobile wallets will not be necessary for online payments, because UPI allows a customer to pay directly from a bank account to different merchants, both online and offline. And we have covered UPI in detail in our economic survey lectures, right? So if you have gone through those lectures, you can very easily answer this question. So the correct answer here is A. Mobile wallets will not be necessary for online payments. Now let's come to question number 69. The term event horizon, singularity, string theory, and standard model are sometimes seen in news in the context of A. observation and understanding of the universe. B. study of the solar and lunar eclipses. C. placing satellites in the orbit of the Earth. D. origin and evolution of living organisms on Earth. And if you have gone through our lecture on gravitational wave, you can easily answer this question, because we have spoken about singularity, we have spoken about event horizon and string theory there. Okay, so the correct answer is A. observation and understanding of the universe. Let's come to question number 70. With reference to agriculture in India, how can the technique of genome sequencing, often seen in news, be used in immediate future? 1. Genome sequencing can be used to identify genetic markers for disease resistance and drought tolerance in various crop plants. Yes, the statement is correct. Statement number 2. This technique helps in reducing the time required to develop new varieties of crop plants. Even this statement is correct. Statement number 3. It can be used to decipher the host pathogen relationship in the crops. Right. This statement is also correct. So the correct answer here is D, 1, 2 and 3. Now let's come to question number 71. The main advantage of parliamentary form of government is that A. executive and legislature work independently. B. it provides continuity of policy and is more efficient. C. the executive remains responsible to the legislature. And D. the head of the government cannot be changed without election. So the correct answer here is C. executive remains responsible to the legislature. Now let's come to question number 72. In the context of India, which one of the following is the correct relationship between the rights and the duties? Again, a question from polity. A. rights are correlative with duties. Statement is correct, obviously. We cannot talk about rights without talking about fundamental duties, right? To ensure somebody's right, somebody else has to perform his fundamental duties. So the correct answer here is A. Now let's come to question number 73. The mind of the makers of Constitution of India is reflected in which of the following? A. preamble. B. fundamental rights. C. directive principles of state policy. And D. fundamental duties. The correct answer is A. preamble. The preamble is the heart and soul of the Constitution. It is an introduction to the Constitution. It talks about the aspiration of the people of India, right? So that is why preamble reflects the mind of makers of the Constitution of India. Now let's come to question number 74. If you travel by road from Kohima to Kottayam, what is the minimum number of states within India through which you can travel, including the origin and destination? Kohima is in Nagaland and Kottayam is in Kerala. And the correct answer here is B, 7 states. So because you have to pass through Nagaland, then Assam, then we have West Bengal, then Odisha, then Andhra Pradesh, then Tamil Nadu, and then Kerala. So this is the route. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 states, right? So the correct answer here is B7. Let's come to question number 75. The Parliament of India exercises control over the functions of the Council of Ministers through 1. Adjournment motion, 2. Question hour, 3. Supplementary questions. Select the correct answer using the code given below. A. 1 only, B. 2 and 3 only, C. 1 and 3 only, and D. 1, 2 and 3. And the correct answer here is D. 1, 2 and 3. All the 3 are correct. Let's come to question number 76. With reference to the Parliament of India, consider the following statements. 1. A private member's bill is a bill presented by a member of Parliament who is not elected but only nominated by the President of India. No, this is incorrect. A private member's bill is actually a bill which is presented by a member of the Parliament who is a member of the Parliament but not a minister. So these MPs, when they raise a bill, that is called a private member's bill, right? So statement 1 is incorrect. Statement number 2. Recently, a private member's bill has been passed in the Parliament of India for the first time in its history. Even this statement is incorrect. Because the first private member bill was not passed recently, it was passed in 1968. And this question is there in the paper because there was a bill passed recently, the Rights of Transgender Persons Bill 2014, which was passed by Rajya Sabha. It was a private member bill, right? So the correct answer here is D, neither 1 nor 2. Now let's come to question number 77. With reference to the difference between the culture of Rigvedic Aryans and Indus Valley people, which of the following statements is or are correct? Statement number 1. Rigvedic Aryans used the coat of mail and helmet in warfare, whereas the people of Indus Valley civilization did not leave any evidence of using them. The statement is correct. Statement number 2. Rigvedic Aryans knew gold, silver and copper, whereas Indus Valley people knew only copper and iron. This statement is incorrect. Statement number 3. Rigvedic Aryans had domesticated the horse, whereas there is no evidence of Indus Valley people having been aware of this animal. This statement is also incorrect. Because according to NCERT, there are some evidences of horse bones in places such as Surkotada. So Indus Valley people were actually aware of horse. So the correct answer here is A, 1 only. Now let's come to question number 78. Recognition of prior learning scheme is sometimes mentioned in the news with reference to A. Certifying the skills acquired by construction workers through traditional channels. B. Enrolling the persons in universities for distance learning programs. C. Reserving some skilled jobs to rural and urban poor in some public sector undertakings. D. Certifying the skills acquired by trainees under the National Skill Development Program. The correct answer here is A. Certifying the skills acquired by the construction workers through traditional channels. This we have discussed in one of the previous questions, right? Now let's come to question number 79. From the ecological point of view, which one of the following assumes importance in being a good link between the Eastern Ghats and the Western Ghats? A. Satyamangalam Tiger Reserve, B. Nallamala Forest, C. Nagarhole National Park, and D. Seshachalam Biosphere Reserve. The correct answer here is Satyamangalam Tiger Reserve. So it is a forest range which is a significant wildlife corridor in the Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve between the Western Ghat and the rest of the Eastern Ghat, located in the Erode district of Tamil Nadu. So it is a kind of it provides a kind of connectivity between the Eastern and the Western Ghats, and this was in news for quite some time. That is why this question is asked in the prelims. Now let's come to question number 80. One of the implications of equality in the society is the absence of A. Privileges, B. Restraints, C. Competition, D. Ideology. The correct answer here is A. Privileges, right? So the term equality actually means the absence of special privileges to any section of the society, and everyone has adequate opportunities without any discrimination. So correct answer here is A. Privileges. Question number 81. Consider the following statements in respect of traffic, trade-related analysis of fauna and flora in commerce. Statement number 1. Traffic is a bureau under United Nations Environment Program. The statement is incorrect. It is an NGO basically. It is not a part of UNEP. So statement 1 is incorrect here. Coming to statement number 2, the mission of traffic is to ensure that trade in wild plants and animals is not a threat to the conservation of the nature. This sounds to be true, and this is true actually, right? So the correct answer here is B, 2 only. Now let's come to question number 82. Which principle among the following was added to the DPSP, Directive Principles of State Policy, by the 42nd Amendment to the Constitution, which took place in 1976? A. Equal pay for equal work for both men and women. B. Participation of workers in the management of industries. C. Right to work, education and public assistance. D. Securing living, wage and human conditions to work to workers. The correct answer here is B. Participation of workers in the management of the industries. Okay. Now let's come to question number 83. Which one of the following statements is correct? A. Rights are claims of state against the citizens. B. Rights are privileges which are incorporated in the constitution of a state. C. Rights are claims of the citizen against the state. And D. Rights are privileges of a few citizens against many. So the correct answer here is C. Rights are claims of the citizens against the state. Now let's come to question number 84. Which one of the following gives global gender gap index ranking to the countries of the world? So the options are A. World Economic Forum, B. UN Human Rights Council, C. UN Women, and D. World Health Organization. And the correct answer here is World Economic Forum. World Economic Forum gives global gender gap index ranking to the countries of the world. And what is India's rank there? India's rank is 87 out of 144 countries. Now let's come to question number 85. Which of the following statements is or are correct regarding the Smart India Hackathon 2017? 1. It is a centrally sponsored scheme for developing every city of our country into smart city in a decade. Statement is incorrect. Statement number 2. It is an initiative to identify new digital technology innovations for solving the many problems faced by our country. This statement is correct. Statement number 3. It is a program aimed at making all the financial transactions in our country completely digital in a decade. Even this statement is incorrect. The correct answer here is B. 2 only. Right? So Smart India Hackathon was a 36 hours non-stop digital product development competition during which teams of thousands of technology students built innovative digital solutions for the problems which were posted by 29 different central government ministries or departments. For example, Ministry of Railways has given some problem which they are facing. Students have, you know, proposed their ideas in the arena of digital technology to solve those problems. And that is what Smart India Hackathon was all about, right? Now let's come to question number 86. Which of the following statements is or are correct regarding the Monetary Policy Committee, MPC? 1. It decides RBI's benchmark interest rates. Yes, that is what the purpose of MPC is. Statement number 2. It is a 12-member body including the governor of RBI and it is reconstituted every year. This statement is incorrect because it is not a 12-member body. It is a 6-member body. Okay. Statement number 3. It functions under the chairmanship of Union Finance Minister. No, this statement is also incorrect because the chairman of MPC is not Union Finance Minister. It is RBI Governor. RBI Governor is the ex officio chairman of the Monetary Policy Committee, right? And it is a 6-member body which decides the RBI's benchmark interest rates, repo rate and reverse repo rate, etc. So the correct answer here is A. 1 only. Only statement 1 is correct. Let's come to question number 87. With reference to Manipuri Sankirtana, this is a question from Art and Culture. Consider the following statements. 1. It is a song and dance performance. Yes, absolutely correct. Cymbals are the only musical instruments used in the performance. Cymbals are the instrument called manjira in Hindi. Cymbals are the only musical instruments used in the performance. So already I have given you one tip that wherever you find this word only, you should become extra alert, right? These kind of statements are on an average incorrect statements. So cymbals are the only musical instruments used in the performance. It is a song and dance performance. And how can it take place just with one musical instrument? So this raises doubt. Even if you don't know it, you can just eliminate this option. Statement number 3, it is performed to narrate the life and deeds of Lord Krishna. This statement is correct. Sankirtana is actually associated with the Bhakti movement, the Vaishnava sect. So they narrate the life and deeds of Lord Krishna during Sankirtana. And this is practiced in the Manipur region. Which of the statement given above is or are correct? The correct answer here is B. 1 and 3 only. Statement 2 is incorrect. And this is the dance and song performance we are talking about, the Manipuri Sankirtana. Here you can see these instruments, these drums and cymbals are present. So cymbals are not the only instruments which are used in Manipuri Sankirtana. And there was a question on Sankirtana because it is a part of UNESCO heritage list and it was added in 2013. It is the most recent edition, one of the most recent editions, right? So you should always go through the UNESCO heritage list of intangible and tangible heritage, right? And there are a lot of questions asked in those areas. That is an important section which you can go through in the art and culture section. Now let's come to question number 88. Who among the following was or were associated with the introduction of Rewari settlement in India during the British rule? 1. Lord Cornwallis. 2. Alexander Reed. 3. Thomas Monro. The correct answer here is 2 and 3 only. Lord Cornwallis is not associated with Rotwari system. Lord Cornwallis is actually associated with Zamindari system. And Alexander Reed and Thomas Monro are associated with the Rotwari settlement in India. So the correct answer here is C, 2 and 3 only. And this question is from the land revenue system during the British India. And these were some of the land revenue systems prevalent at that time. There was permanent settlement, which was introduced in 1739 by Lord Cornwallis. It is also known as the Zamindari system. Okay. And here the revenue was collected by the Zamindar from the peasants, the farmers, and it was handed over to the British. So Zamindar was the intermediary between the farmers and the British. And then Rotwari system was established in 1800 in Madras and Bombay Presidency in 1835. And here the company collected revenue directly from the farmers. So there was no intermediary as such. Then there was another system called Mahalwari system, which was introduced in 1822. And it was prevalent in the northwest provinces of India. And here there was a village headman who was a part of the village, and he was responsible for the revenue collection. So these were the most prevalent and most important land revenue systems during the British in India. Now let's come to question number 89. In the context of solving pollution problems, what is or are the advantage or advantages of the bioremediation technique? So before going to the options, let's have a look at what is bioremediation actually. So bioremediation is a technique where microorganisms are used to consume the pollutants in a certain area. Right, so they are used to fight pollution, and mostly this technique is used during the oil spills. Okay, so what happens here is bacteria eats away the oil and hydrocarbon waste, and it digests and metabolizes it and turns it into water and harmless gases, and it releases the water and gases back into the nature. So the pollutant is converted into non-harmful products with the help of these microorganisms. Right, that is what bioremediation is. Now let's see what are the options. Statement number 1, it is a technique for cleaning up pollution by enhancing the same biodegradation process that occurs in nature. Obviously this is correct. Statement number 2, any contaminant with heavy metals such as cadmium and lead can be readily and completely treated by bioremediation using microorganisms. This statement is not correct, because biodegradation has to happen and it cannot take place on cadmium and lead, these kind of heavy metals. Okay. Statement number 3, genetic engineering can be used to create microorganisms specifically designed for bioremediation. This statement is correct. Okay. Select the correct answers using the code given below. The correct answer here is 1 and 3 only, that is C. Okay. The Trade Disputes Act 1929 provided for A. Participation of workers in the management of industries. B. Arbitrary power to the management to quell industrial disputes. C. An intervention by the British court in the event of a trade dispute. And D, a system of tribunals and ban on strikes. The correct answer here is D. This is also a factual question. And Trade Dispute Act 1929 was one of the earliest law to regulate the relationship between the employer and its workmen. And it made compulsory the appointment of courts of inquiry and consultation boards for settling industrial disputes. And it made illegal for the strikes in public utility services like post, railways, water and electricity. And if they are planning for a strike, they have to give 1 month notice. All these kind of rules were brought in when the Trade Dispute Act was enacted in 1929. Okay. Now let's come to question number 91. Local self government can be best explained as an exercise in A. Federalism, B. Democratic decentralization, C. Administrative delegation, and D. Direct democracy. The correct answer here is B. Democratic decentralization. So where local self-government in India can be seen? It can be seen in the form of the village panchayats, in the form of municipalities in the cities, right? So what we are doing basically, we are decentralizing the democracy. So the correct answer here is B, democratic decentralization. Now let's come to question number 92. Consider the following statements. With reference to the Constitution of India, the directive principles of state policy constitute limitations upon 1. Legislative function, 2. Executive function. Which of the following statements is or are correct? And the correct answer here is D, neither 1 nor 2. Because DPSPs are not enforceable. These are just directions to the government, right? So they do not put any limitation on the legislative or executive function. What puts a limitation on the legislative and executive function of a government are fundamental rights. because they operate as a limitation to the tyranny of the executive and arbitrary laws of the legislature. So if the legislative action or the executive action of the government is causing a harm to the fundamental rights of the citizens, they can go to court and challenge those actions or the laws. That is how they become a limitation to the legislative function and the executive function of the government. But that cannot take place in the case of directive principles of state policy. If the government is not implementing any of the DPSPs, it cannot be challenged in the court of law. That is why the correct option here is D, neither 1 nor 2. Now let's come to question number 93. The term digital single market strategy seen in the news refers to A, ASEAN, B, BRICS, C, EU and D, G20. The correct answer here is C, European Union. So the digital single market strategy was in news recently and it was adopted by European Union on 6th May 2015. And it includes 16 specific initiatives which aims to open up digital opportunities for the people and businesses, that is aimed to enhance Europe's position as a world leader in the digital economy. Now let's come to question number 94. At one of the places in India, if you stand on the seashore and watch the sea, you will find that the seawater recedes from the shoreline a few kilometers and comes back to the shore twice a day. And you can actually walk on the seafloor when the water recedes. This unique phenomena is seen at A. Bhavnagar, B. Bhimunipatnam, C. Chandipur and D. Nagpatnam. The correct answer here is C. Chandipur, right? Let's come to question number 95. With reference to Prohibition of Benami Property Transactions Act 1988, consider the following statements. 1. A property transaction is not treated as a Benami transaction if the owner of the property is not aware of the transaction. This statement is incorrect. Properties held Benami are liable for confiscation by the government. Yes. Absolutely correct. Statement number 3. The Act provides for three authorities for investigations but does not provide for any appellate mechanism. This statement is incorrect. There is an appellate mechanism. The appeals can be made to the appellate tribunal. So the correct answer here is B, 2 only. Let's come to question number 96. Due to some reason, if there is a huge fall in the population of species of butterflies, what could be its likely consequence or consequences? 1. Pollination of some plants could be adversely affected. Yes, that is correct. Statement number 2, there could be a drastic increase in the fungal infection of some cultivated plants. No, that is not necessary. Statement number 3, it could lead to a fall in the population of some species of wasps, spiders and birds. This statement is correct because some of these species feed on butterflies. So the correct answer here is C, 1 and 3 only. Statement number 2 is incorrect. Let's come to question number 97. It is possible to produce algae based biofuels. But what is or are the likely limitations of developing countries in promoting this industry? Statement number 1. Production of algae-based biofuels is possible in the seas only and not on continents. This statement is incorrect. It can take place in the lab also. Statement number 2. Setting up and engineering the algae-based biofuel production requires a high level of expertise or technology until the construction is completed. This statement is correct. Statement number 3, economically viable production necessitates the setting up of large-scale facilities which may raise ecological and social concerns. This statement is also correct. So the correct answer here is B, 2 and 3 only. Let's come to question number 98. Which of the following are the objectives of National Nutrition Mission? 1. To create awareness relating to malnutrition among the pregnant women and lactating mothers. Statement is correct. Statement number 2, to reduce incidence of anemia among young children, adolescent girls and women. Even this statement is correct. Statement number 3, to promote the consumption of millets, coarse cereals and unpolished rice. This statement is incorrect. Statement number 4, to promote the consumption of poultry eggs. Even this statement is incorrect. So correct answer here is 1 and 2 only. That is A. Now let's come to question number 99. Consider the following statements. 1. The Factories Act 1881 was passed with a view to fix wages of industrial workers and to allow the workers to form trade unions. The statement is incorrect. There was no provision for the fixed wage and the formation of trade unions. Statement number 2. N.M. Lokhande was a pioneer in organizing the labor movement in British India. Statement number 2 is correct. So the correct answer here is B, 2 only. So the Factories Act of 1881 was actually a relief to the workers at that time because the act prohibited the employment of children under the age of 7 and it limited the number of working hours for the children below the age of 12 and it mandated that the dangerous machinery should be fenced properly, those kind of safety provisions. And the act also made a provision for 1 hour rest during the working period and 4 days leave in a month for the workers. And it appointed inspectors to supervise the implementation of these measures. And there was no provision for the fixed wage and the formation of trade unions, right? So let's move to the last question, question number 100. In the context of mitigating and impending global warming due to anthropogenic emissions of carbon dioxide, which of the following can be the potential sites of carbon sequestration? So before going to the options, let's understand what is carbon sequestration. So carbon sequestration is actually a natural or an artificial process by which the carbon from atmosphere is taken up and stored in solid or liquid form, right? So here you can see that there is a power station which is emitting CO2, right? And what happens here is the trees during photosynthesis, they intake carbon dioxide. So they are taking up carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and storing it in solid or liquid form. And similarly, oceans also absorb carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and they store in the liquid form. And similarly, it can be stored in the unminable coal beds. It is stored in the saline formations in the ground, right? So there are three types of carbon sequestration. There is terrestrial sequestration by the trees and plants, etc. during photosynthesis. There is ocean sequestration, right? Ocean also stores carbon dioxide. And there is subterranean sequestration, that is underground, right? So that is what is carbon sequestration. Now let's come back to the question. The question is, in the context of mitigating and impending global warming due to anthropogenic emissions of carbon dioxide, which of the following can be the potential sites of carbon sequestration? So what are the potential sites of carbon sequestration where it can be stored? One, abandoned and uneconomic coal seams, correct. Statement number two, depleted oil and gas reservoirs, yes, correct. And statement number three, subterranean deep saline formations. That is also correct. So they are actually talking about subterranean carbon sequestration. So correct answer here is D, 1, 2 and 3, right? So that's all, guys. That's all from our side in this lecture. If you like this video, please hit the like button and please share your feedback in the comment section. And please subscribe to the channel if you have not done so that you don't miss any important lecture. And the most important thing, you can download all the slides of all our lectures from our Facebook page. The link is provided in the description section of all the videos, right? So that's all for now. We'll meet you soon. Till then, take care, bye-bye, and prepare well.